administrative offices.
I'm going to call this meeting of the Historic District Commission to order. It's 1:03 on June 29th. Present at this time are John McLaughlin, Diane Coombs, Val Oliver, TJ Waterson, Abby Camp, and myself, Ray Pohl. Anyone who wants to record any portion of today's meeting should let us know in advance. The whole meeting is being recorded right now anyway. And anyone who wants to have a conversation in the audience outside of what's being discussed at the table should probably do it in the hallway. Can I have, can somebody approve today's agenda? Okay. You move to approve?
Yes.
Okay. Do you have a question regarding the agenda?
No.
Oh. It's discussion of the trim color at the new school.
Was it put on every time?
Oh, I'm sure it was.
It was put on.
Yeah.
An application.
Okay, I'll make sure. Huh?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. So we have a motion to approve today's agenda. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. Any public comment today? Hearing none, we will move right on to new business.
Excuse me, sir.
Oh, yes. Yes. Sorry.
May I?
Yeah, please.
I'm sending after our owner with my wife, 22 Broadway in Sunset.
Oh, yeah.
And have a comment about the sign at 25 Broadway that's been erected.
Right. Now, that is actually being covered. That is noticed today, and that will be on the agenda for what we call other business. If you look at our, do you have a copy of this?
I saw that, and because it's late in the agenda, I wondered if I might offer a comment and then depart.
Can we entertain it? All right. The only thing that we can't do for you, just so you know
yes.
the rules, public comment, the board members can listen,
yes.
but they cannot respond.
I understand.
Okay? You got that?
Certainly.
All right. Then fine. Go ahead.
Just by way of introduction, by profession, I'm a counselor and real estate public official in Washington, and by avocation, historic preservation. This is the seventh historic house that we have restored as a couple. We are just finishing our restoration, which was about a year and a half ago, and are one of several neighbors who are concerned about the sign that has gone up on the top of 25 Broadway, which reads Spencer's Store. We do understand that this commission approved the sign. None of us, that is, as neighbors, have been consulted on it, either by this commission or by the owners, and we're surprised at that, frankly. We, incidentally, are very enthusiastic about the quality of their restoration. It's been an excellent job, and we're all happy with that. This is the only aspect, however, which we think is inappropriate, very unattractive, actually could diminish values in the immediate area, and would like to ask in whatever way is appropriate, we're not familiar with the procedure, frankly, that the owners be requested to remove it. From a personal perspective, the sign itself is terrific. It can go over their fireplace. Plaque can go on the door explaining the history of the house and the immediate area. There were actually three other stores, we understand, in the immediate area a century or more ago. But at present, it is obtrusive in a work. So I won't, you all have probably seen it, there are pictures and so on. But and I'm not representing anyone except ourselves at this moment, although four other neighbors agree with our viewpoint. I appreciate your consideration and hope that you will support the proposal.
Thank you. So we will take that your comments into consideration when the board reviews this at the end of today's meeting.
Thank you very much.
Right.
Appreciate
it. It's the sign on the Broadway
schools. Is this number two? The original HDC application, the architect filled in that we were going to paint the trim, and that was in error. Nowhere in our bid specs was it intended to paint the trim. The elementary school that faces the new intermediate school has cedar trim, which is natural to the weather, and our intent was to always just leave the trim with the cedar natural. So we're requesting a change so that to match.
Motion to approve.
Is there any further discussion on this?
Application?
First of all, let me clarify the board. It's irregular members.
And could you clarify? It's natural now.
The problem was that apparently when we received the application, John picked this up on the review at the final sign-off, and he noticed that the trim, meaning the window casings, the rakes, the corner board, et cetera, were all called out as being gray, painted gray. And then I don't think anybody really reviewed it or discussed it, and the intention of the applicant was to leave everything natural. So the request at this time is to have it as natural, which is the way it is right now.
No maintenance.
And we just for point of reference, in the past 2 years, the school has spent over $322,000 on repainting the high school, middle school. It took 2 years because of the capital request to get that done. And I just think because the other school faces it and it's also natural, it just made so much sense to leave this one natural as well.
The other school meaning?
The elementary school.
Yeah, which has natural trim with red sash. Yeah.
Are the sashes terracotta? Is that what they are now?
I can't tell.
It's Quaker gray, I believe.
Yeah, it looks like Quaker gray. John?
This is a new school, right? The
correct.
Building? Mm-hmm. All right. Starting to this here. It's got a white trim on the casing to the window.
I don't think it's white, John.
It's not white.
It's the sunlight.
This is
on the
one of the temporary. Isn't
it
this
Diane?
Yes,
no.
This is the
brand
new building.
Can we just
brand
move this along?
Well, I just want to make sure everybody understands what is going on.
Chinese that are rock proof and weather and humidity. So you're saying
the question is the rake cardboard and follow the trim around the window is going to be
natural, which is just what you said. That's. Oh.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you.
Okay, so there is a motion on the table to approve this as a natural trim.
Sure.
Any further discussion?
No.
All those in favor of Val's motion to approve this as natural trim?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Abstention?
Okay, brush out tomorrow.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks. All right, now on to Richmond.
That's for you, sir.
Good.
Well, we know this is, in our opinion, we realize that turning it around in a week is a little tight, so what we did is we have copies of this elevation, and Diane will walk you through that.
Okay.
The site plan isn't quite ready yet.
Is your name Diane or Diane?
Diane. Diane that left us.
Okay.
I
just want to make sure.
Okay. Yeah, sure. We have small copies and large copies. And we have a site plan as well to show you location, which we'll pass around, which you've seen before.
So everybody will get a black and white.
But the final site plan is not quite ready, so I apologize for that. We've already made some. Diana's already thought through some changes, so I think she'll incorporate that into her presentation too. So anybody else need it?
ones the same as the big
yes.
ones?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
It's just that I have a site plan with it.
Oh. Yeah, we'd like to see the site plan.
I don't think. Well, this is the same.
Oh, you got it. Okay.
Well, is this it?
Yes.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
it's not
so
any different.
So you have this, right?
Yeah, it's just labeled with Meadows 1 and
Meadows
2.
Oh.
That's Meadowlands 2.
It was at least requested last week, so we thought we'd include that, even though we want to focus on the structure today
mm-hmm.
as we start moving towards the elevations and getting a sense from you of what you're going to find acceptable.
Yeah.
He's so open.
Why don't you start with the structure and just walk us through what you think about it?
Space
is this area here.
Mm-hmm.
Currently, there are the diner here, the liquor store, those
mm-hmm.
that configuration on Lover's Lane.
Sorry.
Thanks. So the two buildings that have been approved are this one on lot one, and this are three buildings, lot two and lot three, and that's the UPS store in the middle. It's going to be the new UPS store.
I think
oh, the
talking
new one.
About the current one.
Yeah,
oh,
yeah. You know, I got the reference now. Sorry.
Oh, okay. So currently, to come into the development, you come down, and what you see here is a white entry, which is not a legal road, and we'll be moving that and reconfiguring that with respect to the traffic plan. So the old UPS store is here.
Okay.
Okay.
Yep.
And so it winds down and connects with Nancy Ann. We'll be moving the entry further down, so you're not doing this sort of dueling thing with the Goldfinch entrance,
mm-hmm.
which is what is going on now. And move further down, obviously widening the road, putting in some medians, things of that sort, and then the road will be straighter. Cape Cod Express is still back here. They own that property. Our office is currently about here. Skyline Drive is this way, you know, this way. The Evergreen Daffodil neighborhood is here.
Mm-hmm.
So Daffodil feeds in here, Evergreen's over here. And then this is commercial industrial still, and will remain commercial industrial, which is the faith, you know, essentially next to the apartments.
Mm-hmm.
John got it.
This yellow part with the AB buildings, that's not part of
yes.
Meadowlands 2, right?
That's going to be the
single family
houses that we will view later.
Right. If I can get the abutters list, because it's a bit of a trick to do that with the fact that the roads are all different.
Yeah.
I'm going to try to get those in for your next week's deadline.
No, that's the third time I can't see that. You know, the presentation isn't correct. All right. I want to know what's going on. Jackson, where you're talking about, you go around here with a pen. I don't even know what it means.
I was answering a question, John, about the single family homes in the yellow. And the yellow designates where the single family homes will be. And I was saying that we probably hope to be in at least within a month with our first two single family home elevations. So we'll be doing this with at the same time that we're doing the discussions on the apartments.
Mm-hmm.
Okay?
Okay.
So it's not going to be one then the other, just to be clear.
So John, what we're reviewing today is this.
Right. The apartments.
The green here.
The green.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah,
they all.
No.
Similar?
No.
Just one building today.
One building today. This is us. We're walking through this from the entrance back. And
right.
this building we hope to have located right here. This configuration is not correct in terms of your site plan. We're still working on the site plan. We want to know what you would like at the entrance. And so we're starting there. And this building will be unique. It will be repeated throughout the development. So.
Mm.
Okay?
Right.
The rest of the buildings we talked about last week conceptually will have different configurations. We'll be designed differently with different Nantucket features on them.
There's nine prototypes, nine modules.
Prototypes.
Mm-hmm.
But we're starting with one today, the entrance one, which we figure sets the tone. So we started there. It's also the simplest building at this point. And that's what we want to look at the elevations for.
My question, all in the green have been discussed today.
No, one building.
Where is that one building? Right here in the corner? This one.
So, John?
Details help, you know.
John, the reason that they're presenting this one building first is because when you drive in, this is going to be the first building that you see, and all the other ones are going to be behind it.
Okay, but I'm just saying, no. Yeah, I want to get sure there's no plot plan, that's why.
This is not a formal application. We're hoping to walk through conceptually with you. If we were to make a formal application, then we would be obviously putting together the rest of the package, so.
Yeah, we just can't, I don't think we can operate without having, you know, a plot plan, everything that goes with it, we can open up, they can explain it all, you know?
You tell me, because we would rather have you input on the concept and then go back to the application package, which includes the rest of it.
Preliminary hearing.
I just
preliminary.
When you're making the green, I didn't know what you were saying up there in the green and these buildings here.
Okay.
That's where I was off on.
Okay.
Know? Thank you. Okay, I understand.
Okay. So, Abby, you had a question.
It says when this arrow that says community focal point open space, I just wanted to orient myself that is going to be like some kind of garden or.
Yes.
Right, and that's adjacent to the building that we're going
adjacent,
to be reviewing.
Right, to module. We're calling it module E for
okay.
today.
Okay, and then, Stephen, you had a question.
Yeah, it's okay. I just want to make sure to clarify, because I think John followed through on that. What you're doing is you're presenting a concept. You pick the one near the front because it's the entry. However, you're still planning on bringing in the slew of, using the term not derogatory, but the whole of it before formal applications.
Absolutely.
For any particular structure so that the commission can view them as a whole.
Right.
And then make determinations on particular applications.
Absolutely.
Okay, I just wanted to make it.
We're trying, obviously, as I said last time, this is a new concept for the island. It's never been considered before. Our intent is to get your feedback before we get too far into the details of each of the structures. So, yes, we fully intend to come back. I believe you did this with the hospital and with the school as well.
Mm-hmm.
And we consider ourselves that level of development. So,
thank you.
Essentially what we're coming from.
I think the other nice thing is it also involves the whole board, not just sitting members. So, I have a question. One of the things that you led off saying is that this is sort of a standalone piece, that it's unique. Does that mean that there's sort of like a higher level of trim and detail, et cetera, et cetera?
It's kind of up to you.
I think we just need to propose what's here today. And
well, in other words, so some of the elements that I see on this could carry through into some of the other buildings?
I don't see why not.
Okay, just asking.
Right. It's just like when we go through the massing a little bit, it might be a little more unique than the other modules.
Okay,
so again, just to reiterate what Patty was saying, these are obviously are not single-family homes, and they're not going to look like a single-family home, but we understand it's new to Nantucket, and we're filling a need here. Okay, what we did on this particular elevation, first, my apologies, instead of saying front elevation, it should say north elevation. On A01, this is actually the north elevation and the west elevation. And on page 2 is the south elevation and the east elevation. That will be presented on the next go around. So essentially, we're given a building that's about 72 feet long by about 30 feet wide. And we want to break up the facade on the north and the south elevations. And so we're proposing a gable element that's going to be proud of the rest of the building by 4 feet. So it's going to bump 4 feet forward. So along the gable lines, or where we have the trim,
yeah.
This portion will be proud by 4 feet to the rest of the building.
So it's not like it's drawn on the side, then?
The way it's drawn on the side is
it's flush.
Yes.
But it will be proud.
Yes, yeah. So
okay.
It's a work in progress, but we're going to bring in 4 feet proud of that.
That's good.
That was the first comment I just want to make on the north elevation.
Mm-hmm.
And then for the entries, this particular building, we're going to be having the facade facing the park. but that's really not the main entry for the residents. There'll be another entry in the back of the building on the south side, and that has the shed room for entry. So if you go to page 2, that's north, facing the park. Here, I apologize on the front. That's north, and then the bottom one would be west. And then we have, this unit happens to have four apartments in it, two two-bedrooms on the first floor, two two-bedrooms on the second floor. So the window pattern, again, on the facade of the south, of the north facade is a little different than the south facade because just the way the floor plans work out. Mm-hmm. So it's not going to be like an exact replica from a mirror image or anything like that. And anyway, it's a way of breaking up the long building and giving it some shade and shadow. And then again, the porch will be 6 feet in front of the 4 foot gable feature. That's kind of the overall idea of the massing on the first building.
Okay. Thank you. Oh, and just so we all know, what are your sort of anticipated color? What's the paint? Or is it natural? Or?
We're anticipating at this time all the natural cedar shingles.
Mm-hmm. Yes, but so the rakes and the corner boards and the window casings.
I think it was cobblestone on the meadows.
Okay.
That informs anything.
Oh, all right. Okay. Good to know.
For trim and sash?
Yes. And the windows are the Anderson 400 series, the 6/6 double hung.
The liner buildings were green sash and white trim. But that's farther away.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. You will bring it
right.
Other than that, we were thinking just all monochromatic as far as the sashes.
You mean throughout this
module?
Yeah. What I meant was within your multi-family building.
No, I mean we're open, and that's why we thought this was important that we can change that up.
All right, so that will be for another day. But
right.
You're thinking that you could keep it the same or make it different. All right. So,
I'll go.
Go. Yeah.
I appreciate it bumping out 4 feet because when I started looking at this,
mm-hmm.
I'm like, it's no different than the buildings that are there, except you have a gable. So thank you for that. I think if there's a way, and there is a way, there has to be a way, to drop this 72-foot ridge perhaps down just slightly from the gable forward so that it looks somewhat like additive mass, that would be great.
Yes. We can do that by just narrowing up that 30-foot module to like 24 feet. The side is 30 feet now, we can narrow it, and that would naturally bring the gable lower.
That would be terrific.
Yeah.
Yeah, just make it, I won't make it so wide.
Mm-hmm.
I think that would go a long way.
Okay. That's easy. I mean, nothing's easy. Right, the 18 inches.
Yeah.
Right. Okay, thanks.
And Val, I can come back to you, or if you have more comments.
Well, that was my overall. I get that simplicity is good. I think, though, gestures like having some break in the facade and lowering pieces here and there go a long way for me.
Absolutely.
Yes. Exactly.
Anyone else ready to comment on this? John?
Yeah. I comment here. The 75 feet is what bothers me when they're peeking out right together because that doesn't break it. Usually you have a 1 or 2 foot break.
He doesn't
so,
listen.
So, well. So, John?
You say you're going to do it. Fine.
Right, that's going to be
yeah. Okay, so he basically reiterated what Val just said. No, it's fine. It's fine.
No,
he's just making the same
thing. The lures. Are they wood?
Yes.
And my other comment, I assume these smaller windows compared to the others are not harmonious at all from taking into the bathroom.
They are, correct.
I think this, portico up here serves no purpose other than to have it that high. Maybe a foot, it's a good size, you know, and it just eats up too much of the wall space visually.
Right,
right.
We may be able to lower it up by
8 or 12 inches. This one looks nice. The door is 6 inches more than it should be. 6'6", and this is a 7-foot door. But
oh, really?
Yeah.
Okay. Diane?
I do also appreciate the piece coming out. On your, if you don't break the roof, you have a 72-foot length bridge, and you can't have that, only allowed 50-foot.
Right.
Second of all, why are the ceilings so high? Your first floor ceiling is 9 foot somehow?
They're 8-foot ceilings.
These are modular, correct?
Actually, this...
Are they the stack blocks like...
No, this would be a different system.
Oh.
It's just going to be a metal building, basically.
Site-built.
So
it's site-built.
Site-built, correct.
Are the ceilings 9 feet?
No, they're 8 feet. Maybe
well, the
first floor to second floor and is 9'6".
Oh, okay.
Right, but you have structure of...
You have a foot and a half
about 16
metal
inches.
Metal truss.
Right. So
they're
not
metal truss and other rubbish. So the ceiling is 8 feet.
Yeah, eight feet.
Mm-hmm. They're going to have different, just to say, they're going to have different standards with the construction than a residential.
Correct.
So they're going to need metal in some places.
Yeah, it's helpful to know that, though.
Well, even residential, my standard for the sandwich is 1'2" from the finished floor to the finished ceiling on the first floor. So 1'2", and now they're looking here at 1'6", so the 4-inch difference, basically, which I'm attributing to metal trusses.
And perhaps additional space because they've got separate units, so they're going to need separate utility systems, so it's not like you're going to have a house of this size with plumbing that goes to, you know, all your bathrooms connect to home runs. They'll be, everything's going to be separate.
Okay, let me finish asking some questions.
Go.
Up in the so-called attic, what is going to be up there?
Empty space. Nothing. Unoccupied.
Mechanicals?
So
no,
you have
we
11
have a mechanical
11?
Room on the first floor, and each apartment has a little mechanical closet. And
so literally nothing.
Nothing except draft stopping. And
good to know.
Yes, perhaps you can use that to drop something in your front door, and your back door needs be changed so that the lights don't go all the way down to the bottom.
Right, thank you. Yes, we'll delete the top three lights will remain.
Right.
Okay.
It's just being picky, but I do think...
No, I appreciate it.
The working with that roof and dropping it down, anything one could do to bring it down under 30 feet, which may be the building height, but you are presenting something that as Patty said, has never been in Nantucket, and I'm not sure it ever should be in Nantucket.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it would behoove you to make it as adaptable as possible that we can, you know, approve something that will fit in. And this being your primary building as you're coming in, it's important.
Thank you, Diane. TJ, anything to offer?
Yeah, I do have a few comments. I think it's a nice-looking building, and I like a lot of the features, but I think, you know, you guys have mentioned several times, and we do know the scope, but the project is affordable housing, and I just think that it reads awfully grandeur, a lot of grandeur and formality for affordable housing, and maybe we could simplify some of the trim details, get rid of the soffits, and just maybe go with a frieze and a gutter, get rid of the portico, very formal, and maybe just do a farmer's porch straight across that front of the middle mass.
Mm-hmm. Like with a shed roof you have there?
Yeah, just a shed, farmer's porch all the way across. I scaled the head height of your windows last time you had it. I don't have a floor elevation to scale it off of, but it was 8 feet, the top of the windows.
7'6".
Is it at 7'6"?
Well, the way I got that, TJ, was 5 feet plus 3'6" to grade is 8'6". Less a foot for the first floor,
exactly.
7'6".
My point in being is that if you lowered that window head height and lowered your eave and get rid of the soffit, you could get like maybe a 9 pitch, which is going to look more attractive than an 8 pitch on the building.
Oh, you were talking about
second floor window head height.
I'm sorry,
yeah.
I thought you meant the first floor.
So what I'm saying is if you've got a lot of verticality invested in the eave detail, because... And if you were to simplify that to maybe a 1x10 freeze, you might be able to get a 9 pitch in there.
The only problem with that is the finished floor of the second floor to the sill of the second floor is 24 inches. It would be, I don't want to lower that anymore.
Let me just say one thing.
But,
what we're doing right now is you're getting general comments from the boards. And if within, you know, your structural system or whatever, these comments can't happen, at this point we're offering suggestions, okay? So we don't necessarily need to know that it's going to work or not work. It's just stuff for you to take back.
And also, I don't mind responding to that point. It's also very common in the Nantucket vernacular that the second floor windows will be smaller anyway than the first floor windows. So maybe you can downsize the height of those windows, and then you would still have sill to floor dimension the way you want it. I do appreciate the stepping and the foundation, and the massing. But all in all, I just think it can create a memory after you leave the place of a place that's practical and less formal.
But remember, one of our things that we got to remember, because it keeps coming up, is the cost of something does not.
Oh, I understand. I'm just saying, if they're saying that cost is such an issue, why are we going so formal with fancy trim details?
Well, because that's their decision. We don't approve something because it's cheaper than another way.
Yeah.
Abby?
Yeah, I'm listening to the comments, I think choosing the style of this building is very important, because this is your first thing you're going to see. I think it does look very formal, although it is a sort of scaled down formal. So I think as I look down the road to what else is coming, I think it would be what is going to come off of this for these other buildings. This is a good precedence. Because I think it's simplified. And I think I can see that we had another project on Helmut Pond Road, I think, where he had different styles that in one area, and I'd like to see that develop that way. But that they all related back to this style somehow, in window or, the roof pitch could be the same. So... But on this one in particular, I would say that I was going to go the other way. I was going to say that the bottom windows could be taller. And I don't think affordable housing has to necessarily be skimpy. And I'm glad you made it generous size, actually. I mean, 8-foot ceilings are generous these days, so I'm good with that. But I could see making these windows large the way the Academy Hill has large windows, not that big, but just a little larger than the second story windows. Also, because it's residential, maybe this portico could envelop something friendly like a French door over the portico. It could, so it would look more residential. I don't know if that's in your budget. And maybe instead of, maybe this, the vent could be something not so practical. Maybe it could be
a window.
Yes, I agree with the comments of breaking up the roof line and coming forward is good. And just to recap, I just think that the buildings to follow could come off of this one using the same details, characteristics.
Thank you. Yeah, I generally agree with the comments that have been made so far. I think that this is an improvement over the modules that we approved at Meadows, which are the ones being built now. It has more dimension to it. You know, the fact that this gable is popping out 4 feet and then you have another porch in front, I think these are the things that will help sort of ground the building and reduce its overall scale. I do like Abby's comment about if you can, well, maybe we can sort of do a little bit of both. We'll do a hybrid TJ Abbey mix where you make the second floor windows a little bit smaller and you make the first floor windows a little bit bigger. Now, when I say bigger and smaller, I'm not talking about the width, because personally I like them to be the same width, and I think the width that you have right now is good. I think we're talking about like a taller window on the first floor and a slightly smaller window on the second floor. Because these big windows, in my opinion, actually reduce the perceived size of the building. You know, everyone sort of equates a window with a certain size, and if it's big, it makes the building feel smaller, so I think that would work to your benefit. I am also in favor of having a window as opposed to a louver in the gable ends there, and that might just be something that you have on this, you know, the greet you module, and maybe we don't have those on the back, but I think that given the choice, I think Abby made the comment, this is sort of a utilitarian, you know, vent, a window in that location, that even if it were just on this one building, I think it would be a terrific change, a positive change. And I do like the idea, Diane's idea of dropping that, two side pieces down so that the gable facing us at the two ends on the north and the south are taller, which would break up the ridge. But other than that, I think this is a really good start. So,
I have one comment.
Yes, sir. Go.
On your carnivores going up to your fascia, usually every structure just about being built is 18 foot. And this is 19. That's saving 1 foot in height, getting you down a foot away from a 30 foot height. I can cut it down. That's a possibility, because all homes are 18 foot on the second floor. So, just a suggestion.
Thank you, John. And anything else?
I'd like to make some comments.
Sure. Oh, did I skip over you?
That's all right. I know you know I'm here. I'm not worried about it. I guess I just wanted to kind of reiterate some things and maybe tune them a little bit up with my own perspective. The first was that I appreciate that you're looking at these design elements being, you know, singly important, but also dependent upon the whole, so that, you know, it's part of the bigger process. And part of that would be the level of formality and maybe bringing some. I don't necessarily have an issue with the appropriateness of it being formal or informal, but I think that you can use that as a design element to create variety, not just in terms of, not just use massing, additive massing and architectural elements like dormers and so on and so forth, but you'll be able to use the interplay of formality, informality to create a variation in the presentation and the old perception as you're driving through and living in the place. So those are all important elements, I think, that are appropriate, and as others have brought up. I had a question, and then I have some other comments. Just out of curiosity, your rafter tout on this particular structure, is this on your third floor deck, or is it on your second floor top plates?
Is this your rafter,
mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Are you on your second floor deck? You know, obviously your tail is over here. I'm sorry, my lines are crooked.
That's okay.
Or is it on, so if
oh,
is this the deck,
the,
or is it on the wall?
The ceiling joists?
Yeah, I'm just trying to figure out where it is.
Oh, gosh, that's a really good point.
Because that will make...
That could lower it.
You can also use that in your design. I know that there's an element, slight element, you're going to get into insulation and energy efficiencies with cost, but you might use that as a design element in variation, too, because all of a sudden you can gain a foot or more in reduction or increase without touching the second.
I think it's the, to answer your question, I do believe that is the bearing point of the truss at this point right here.
So these are truss roof.
Right, a truss
roof,
correct.
Which can sit on a top plate or a deck, so that...
Right.
Can we ask a favor of you?
Yeah.
Could you bring us a section through the building?
Sure. Well,
because I have a feeling the way that you're doing it now is the truss is being extended out to create the eave.
Mm-hmm.
All right?
Right, yeah.
Now, if it were done otherwise, if the truss was just laying down and the eave, which isn't really boxed out, there's no soffit, really, that you could actually drop the eave down. And that would take care of John's thing with the 1 foot too high, and it would actually bring that whole eave down a little bit, which would be a huge positive. You see, and you see how from the head of the windows on the second floor to like the top of where the shingles for the roof shingles start is almost 2 feet.
Right.
And I think that that could be reduced considerably, which actually would accrue to you in a cost savings, because then you wouldn't have to run that big freeze board across to make up the space between the eave
and
the so, if that's possible.
Mm-hmm.
And I think we could help you with that just by seeing the section.
I'll also be sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, I do believe it might increase the over. Right now the overhang is only 6 inches on the eave. But
so that aspect of what we're discussing is something you could use on a particular structure, perhaps, you know, it's a suggestion to look at
as
a tool where you might be able to address the commission's concerns about height on a particular building or this particular building, whereas there might be instances where you change the design up in other structures because it gives you a little bit more height without changing roof pitches or things. You might use variability of that design.
Of the wall substrate.
So if you've got
those
together.
Yes.
I think that would be a nice way to distinguish the two that
are,
have to drop
heights.
One. Yeah.
So,
okay.
So,
so I'm clear.
Yep.
I'm asking you this question. Is it going to drop this point to here so that not only will the height drop here, but it will come down so it's more
drop.
Of an additive mass than the eaves going straight across are always a problem.
It depends on how they apply it is
okay.
the answer. Because if they do a certain, you know, they can do different sections in different ways without affecting overall cost dramatic. The change is going to be a cost differentiation, but doing it in different places is going to be proportionate. So you can, it's just like with a structure we do, typically we'll do, say, for instance, a gabled dormer, just to use a very simple illustration. That typically, those rafters typically sit on the top plate of the wall.
Right.
Whereas a gable of a home typically sits on the deck of the third floor, the attic space. So
right.
you gain a foot
yeah.
there. So they would be able to use the same type of a differentiation in their design, however, to create that. So that if the commission felt it needed to be the same straight line eave, they could do that. If we felt that it could be differentiation, they might use that tool or a different way of doing the construction to make the change, is what I was trying to point out.
Right. But I'm glad you pointed it out, because I think having these drop instead of just dropping that height, which will be accomplished by probably just changing the roof pitch, it's a much more successful.
Yeah, I like it where the eave goes straight across. It makes the building look less long.
Yeah, and maybe less complicated in some instances.
Yeah.
So then, Val, that's a great segue into my next comment, which is, I would suggest to you all that it's appropriate to consider down is good, but down and out in the typical sense is not a bad thing. So where we're talking about lowering that ridge on one side 18 inches, in terms of additive massing, I believe it would look more appropriate because it would look more organic if you brought maybe that wing out. If you drop it 18 inches, you might bring it out 18 inches or 2 feet so that you create There's still overall proportionality between the wings, but one of them really, excuse me, clearly has a differentiation of the secondary mass, because historically they'll be a little bit lower, a little bit longer on the back of homes where we have additive masses.
Are you saying have two different treatments on either side of the of this gable? Like this would be treated differently than this side?
If one roof line is lowered, I think it might look more appropriate for it to be the shorter one to be a little bit longer. I think it will create, visually you get a balance. By lowering one side, you're going to create an imbalance. This is a very symmetrical structure, and by lowering one side, you're going to create an asymmetrical condition that's kind of contrary to the overall design. I don't think it's a bad thing to lower it, but I think extending one side would be helpful.
Okay. I actually think that there might have been some misunderstanding. Are you referring to Val's comment about the two different eave heights?
Yeah, I'm just suggesting that
okay,
it could do that to add
What? I don't want to speak for you unnecessarily, but I think that what Val was saying was not to have two different eave heights on either side of the gable. She was saying have the gable that's facing us be one eave height and the ones on either side be lower.
Right.
So
In this building.
Right. Yeah.
As it applies to
so
the module.
Yeah, I mean, I think this design kind of relies on symmetry. And so, you see what, so she's saying keep the gable facing you the way it is and do our treatment with reducing the truss height on either side so that the eaves on either side are lower and they don't line up with the eaves coming on that gable forward.
Right.
Okay.
That's what she's talking about.
So my suggestion is that if you bring in a structure and you have one side lower than the other, don't have the widths the same. So I misunderstood Val's comment. And Val's comment, I think if you lower these, my concern is that if you lower the ridge along the entire length below the front-facing gable, I think that's kind of atypical for, I mean, you're going to have that, the gable ridge, which is only 4 feet off the main structure, is going to be taller than the entire 77-foot ridge.
The ridge is going to be shorter because it's going to die into
it.
It
would feel
it.
Like two additive masses to a main mass in the center.
So,
it's just a comment. It's just a comment.
So, you've heard all of our comments.
Yeah. And can we get floor plans? Because that helps us make
intelligent comments
as well.
We're sort of getting closer. So,
absolutely. Wall section, floor plans.
Right. Okay.
Continue.
This is actually just a preliminary review. So. Not even that.
What book?
We just
I left it up the house.
Actually, there's that.
No, I knocked on the door. Nobody called.
Oh, okay.
You're going to pull it out?
Yes. Thank you very much.
All right. So that's going to go to the back.
Let them come with a couple of different designs.
It's going to be exciting to see what you come up with for the other building.
I know, I mean, I think a lot of the comments actually informed that potential.
When she said
I was just thinking about your connector.
I think we all want a little diversification.
I mean, I realize
that's the most common thing.
Are they going to
I was thinking.
This is what we were talking about. From the side, you can see this process.
Right.
I was thinking that this wasn't going to be there.
Oh.
And I was thinking, that's very strange.
No, I was more concerned with these coming down below the
sun
port
Let's approve some minutes. Can we do that?
Yep.
I have one item on the minutes.
Go for it.
On the June 13 when you get to it. I can't make a motion, so it would be for a revision.
Yeah. So,
You want to revision or do you want it approved as amended?
As amended.
Then you need to explain what the change is.
Yeah, I just wanted to introduce that I was going to do that, and then someone would have to.
No, we're on that now, so you go ahead.
Okay, so it was just on the June 13th with respect to one of the applications. It was just to clarify that the comment was Nantucket was evolving as its now historic buildings were being built. And so the text would be changed to indicate that. It's a very small change. It's just, it clarifies
the
point.
What does it actually say?
Yeah. Currently it says Nantucket is evolving as its now historic buildings built. And what I'm clarifying is Nantucket was evolving as its now historic buildings were being built. So it's just a minor modification to clarify the point.
Only if it comes in a Google search result, people are misinterpreting things.
Well, this was this was 36 Lily Street.
Gotcha. Okay. Got it.
So I think it might be relevant to clarify what, you know, the point was, because it was in response to comments by the neighbors and the applicant.
Yeah.
So. Otherwise, I wouldn't bother.
That would reflect on the tapes, right? I mean, on the transcript.
Yeah, I listened to the tape. It was.
And it's
this is that. Yeah, I mean, Terry's got her hands full over here.
I know.
So
all
I'm not.
So I have to recuse from that anyway, because that is my application, right? That's the.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So I got to recuse, but Diane.
Yes. So, can we put that in, Terry?
Yeah.
All right. Everybody.
So you need a motion to approve as amended.
Right. The June 13th minutes, approve them as amended.
Aye.
Can I have them?
Oh, I wasn't on.
Doesn't matter.
It doesn't matter on the minutes. You're only approving the minutes.
Oh, okay.
Motion to approve the minutes as amended.
Thank you. All those in favor?
Aye.
Anybody opposed? Abstaining?
To amend.
Approve the minutes, but as per an amendment.
It was an amendment to my comments.
A verb was got changed.
Yeah, I had it, but I've written up now.
So are you voting or are you abstaining?
Yeah.
Voting yes?
I'm in favor, yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
So everybody's in favor of that.
All right. Now, John.
Yes, sir.
Your turn.
Okay.
You've waited very long.
Thank you. Well, I'm letting pictures from my old age. I gave three times copies of these two from the guidebook.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. From the first one, 1967, and the this here, these two pages, and, I'm only speaking for the old HDC area in Wisconsin town in Carson, Connecticut. These could be hard and fast rules and regulations. You know, somebody, it's all started with somebody, they had the paint left, which is fine. Somebody come in and well, I want just a little shade darker, a little shade lighter. And the commissioner, as well as myself, said, well, not that bad. Now you're getting almost into a pink on the house, you know, it's just a shame. My question, who's writing the new book?
At the moment, no one.
No one.
No, there's money. You know that there's money set aside to do that. But I don't think that
$30,000.
Yeah, I think they were looking for somebody to. They had somebody, and that person.
Yeah.
We had somebody from the school in Florida.
What pages is he looking at?
Yeah, him. They were going to
Marty Hilton.
The pages John's talking about are the ones in the original book that have the paint colors listed out.
So, John, I just want to say something about that. The hard part is that the original colors don't exist anymore. They keep evolving with the paint company.
The names.
Right. I was going to say that's what happened. You know, somebody wanted a little shade different, so we change shades, and you come back to kick us now. There's so many colors, it isn't funny.
Well, it also, the other problem, John, if I can see that for a second. Like, see Brewster Green here?
Right.
That says Brewster Green. It's a color that is approved on the doors, also known as Essex Green.
Essex Green, yeah.
If you went into Marine Home Center now and you asked for Brewster Green, they wouldn't know what you were talking about.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
So a lot of these, you know, a lot of these colors, you know, we just have to sort of make a judgment as board that is faithful to. There used to be those.
I have a suggestion.
Charts. Yeah, go.
have people bring in a color sample,
a little chip,
and it's stapled to the application.
Because I've seen they still have those little boards that have all the colors with all the names on them. You know, they're around. The old HEC used to have it right there.
Well,
right.
It's on the website, and Marine actually has a little pamphlet with all the HTC colors.
Yeah, they do.
They have all of those paint codes on record. You know, so
but some
USRS is green,
they'll
mix it right up.
That, so it has the new names on it.
They
have
kind of shades when they start.
Had a secondary paint company back 10 or 15 years ago, and it was very good. It was expensive.
Yeah, that was Pratt and Lambert.
But they had one like Concord Paint Company or something
not,
like
Hardee's.
Well,
Hardee's. It was
Hardee's
a buttermilk. It was a buttermilk based paint.
Oh, gosh.
And it did have our, you know, a lot of our colors, but they have done that. They
we're
don't carry that paint
you.
Anymore.
I know, that's the trouble.
We'll come back to you.
Hardee, you
well,
can
you
take down a chip off the wall.
I'm
going to
bring one of those little things in.
I've got one home.
So
I may have one in here.
Yeah, I think they have.
I've got one
finish.
Too. I had Marine write all the RGB values, red, green, blue on it for me. And
so, John, is your concern that there's too much variation?
In the colors, yes. I'm saying, you know, the other, it was more simpler, you know, back in 1965, 68, since 1950. But I'm saying, when the last book was written, you know, the commission got involved with it, along with Chris Lang and Kate Stout, you know. You got together, you made a lot of the meetings, some you couldn't, some you went to. You get a lot of ideas. I think when you start the new book, I won't be here, but when you start the new book, you know, I think they ought to tighten up your lines in the old HDC, because we've had too many things, and my own personal problem that bothered me is a goofy window, right?
Yeah.
That's my thing, you know. Years ago, my thing was where you could see sliding glass doors from the street. That was another thing for the old houses.
And the half rounds.
And the half rounds.
But you've gotten rid of all those.
Yeah.
They're all gone.
That's
now.
On the agenda.
Yeah.
I just wanted to show you that I have this.
Why do I keep getting interrupted?
Because I thought you were done.
But would you give a second to let me finish? Yeah.
Okay. Go ahead, John.
It's exasperating, all right?
Go ahead.
Also,
I just feel that if it starts, the commission should get really involved in the old HCC areas and back off a lot of stuff that's there that has been approved. Although there's only one, we let it go. We know this stuff. You know, I'm asking. I'm not telling anybody what to do. I'm asking in the future, you know, for the memory of me. Just tighten up and tell whoever does it. Tell them. Tighten up your old areas, you know, and especially when you come with a new area in Nantucket, you can do it there too. But, you know, I've seen it go too far downhill over the years from what they originally started with.
Sure.
So, and, you know,
we'll
someday we'll take a meeting and I'll explain it all to you in a couple of weeks.
It will take a couple of weeks, yeah.
So, I'm just saying, I think there should be more emphasis in preserving our history. So wait and see what comes out of it, you know?
We'll get a hold of one of those paint things, and then we can request when people come in for a paint color thing, they bring a little chip of what's getting approved.
Well, I'd say you're bringing that up. A lot of times information isn't here.
If it's other than one of the set colors, right?
Right. Well, even we have to have a standard for the set colors, because it just says like light gray, dark gray.
Well, it does say like Quaker cobblestone. Don't we have those colors listed? Or?
No.
We don't have platinum gray.
If you look at the list there,
there's a difference between what's in the act and the guidebook.
That needs to be
in the actual book versus. Yeah.
Right. So there's a discrepancy between what's in the book, what's in text, and then also what John's saying is there's too much of a variation, at least in the old historic district.
Well, there was a certain type of yellow that was approved on front doors, and I've seen like yellows that were like the color of a daffodil. They were so yellow. So that goes against it. Val, you were going to.
going to make a point just a second ago?
To staple a color with the application.
What was the appendix that you were looking at?
Here, she, TJ.
Appendix G.
In the,
that's the, right there is the original one.
Okay.
The original book.
New book.
I don't have a new version. I have one from 1989 or something. From 1991.
I had one, but I think I gave it
to
Mark.
I don't know that it's changed, has it? Hasn't changed since
it was. You know, the way that you can tell is in the back they have these things about how to deal with you know, solar panels and sort of newer technologies, green technologies. That's an appendix in the newest book.
So 95 is the newest?
Is it 99 or 95?
Okay.
You don't want those?
No, I don't.
Okay. You just made second copy made.
Okay. Okay, so I'll see. I'll make sure I've got. I believe I have. That's the one I have.
Okay. Any further comment?
Do we have to form a committee to do that? The book over. How is that? How does that work? Or does somebody sign on like an RFP?
Here was what the sort of working idea for that was: that someone would be hired with the $30,000 grant money that we have to either use or they're going to take it back. Okay. So, because we actually obtained that money like at least 2 years ago, somebody is hired to initiate and coordinate the redoing of the book, and that person would be educated in, you know, our rules, you know, what things like that, and then at intervals there would be input both from the public and from this board to guide this person along.
Is there like a template somewhere that can be manipulated, or you have to start all the way over?
Well, we have a guidebook.
No, I know, but is
this
that kind of template
be
somewhere?
Some work.
Oh,
done.
I got you. We could scan that and redo it.
Yeah.
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 Good question.
I just had an interesting thing that this was from 1999. Sconset did their own little guidebook, which I thought was kind of interesting.
Yeah.
That's nice. Well written.
Did you see that?
Yeah, I got one home.
Yeah.
Where do you actually get that?
I don't know. I've had it, if you want to look at it.
I've never seen this one.
And then the NHA used to put these out.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, I remember that. Oh, I have a whole bunch of those.
And Edouard, remember him?
Yes.
You know,
Stackpole?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Yeah.
This is the sort of things that should be available.
Yeah, we should have a library or something.
Person.
And Clay Lancaster's books.
Yes.
Kind of standing tall.
Oh my God! What the heck is going on? Are they? That is.
I think this gonna fall
down. I walked
down
by there 2 days ago.
What is it?
It is
TJ?
Crumbling.
It's the place on.
And that place is beautiful.
It is beautiful. Yeah.
I just went in it.
Is that the one on back?
Did you fall to the floor?
No.
Right?
There's a bylaw that prevents that.
I just went in it.
By neglect. No.
Because I know the caretaker.
They actually have a caretaker.
The inside is
a couple of those around town.
It's just
the
outside.
What's the latest?
It's two old sisters that have owned it for years. Apparently, they used to both come down for a week, and I think that they're of an age now that they can't even come down, and they don't have the money to.
But they don't get along either.
Oh, they don't?
Right.
With each other?
With each other.
Oh, that always helps.
The Davises.
But anyway, oh, is that their name?
Mm-hmm.
So, we have done this in the past, and I kind of thought we had
done
it.
We did this.
Yes, we did.
They did shore up the garage over the winter,
yeah,
very
they did
minimally.
Do something to the garage, that's right.
Yeah, that's the worst
five
one.
Or four or 5 years ago, we put them on the list,
and
cited them. That's what we heard from the lawyer. There should be information in our files about it. The lawyer explained that there was a problem between the two sisters, and that he would get to work on it.
Maybe we should turn that burner up again.
And we haven't done that.
It's a great house.
Yeah.
Comment on this.
Oh, is this Sconset? The sign? So are we all set with John's comments? So we'll put together some paint colors.
Some sort of pear tree, huh?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks, John.
Can
and
I?
So now
I'd like just make a quick comment on John's comments.
Because
I think, you know, John, you get a lot of heat. Some of it's deserved, some of it isn't. But, you know, we're all in this together. And with respect to this topic,
I think that the rules and the regulations could be a big help in kind of solidifying everyone's common understanding and philosophy on how rigid to be and following up on certain things. And I think that's important that that be determined. The philosophy may not be something you agree with in the end result, but I think it's important for our group and for people who follow us that we do that, so that there is some consistency and, you know, we take, it helps to eliminate some of the variables, most especially in the old historic district. So I just wanted to add that.
Thank you. Thanks, Steve.
On this?
Okay, so we are now moving on to a discussion about the sign that's on the roof of what's the address?
25 Broadway.
Okay. So here, let me just preface here with some facts. When this was reviewed, everyone on this board, as far as I can recall, was very enthusiastic about the fact that they were going to restore this building. And they presented a photograph of it. You all have this package, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So they presented this photograph, which includes the sign. Okay? And so basically what they, and we gave them sort of a blanket approval to bring back all the old details, on the gable end and, you know, down here, there's certain shingle details, etc. But among those things that we approved was this sign on top. In fact,
it says sign stays.
Okay, so you saw that. So this is the certificate of appropriateness that was signed, and right down there it says sign stays. Okay. So here is the issue, and this is kind of water under the bridge because we approved this sign.
Mm-hmm.
All right. I was not the chairman at the time. It looks like Linda might have been. What's that?
Linda was?
Okay.
That's your signature.
Yeah. So one of the oversights was that the sign should have gone before the sign advisory committee for their input before we approved that with the rest of the package. But I think that we were also, like, delighted that they were restoring this building, that we just sort of said, oh, that's great, go ahead. Well, now there's been some complaints from the neighbors, as you heard earlier. And when I saw it, I actually said to the builder, I said, well, you know, the problem is going to be that everyone's going to think that it's a store, and they're all going to go and knock on the front door and say, so when do you open?
Why would you want that?
Right. And he said, well, we're just going to put a sign up that says gone fishing or something like that. Anyway, so that's the deal. So this is kind of just a discussion about where we are with this. John, I know you've been dying to say something.
Yeah, I had something to say to you.
Yeah.
Number one, sign stage doesn't mean anything in this application because the fact that past policies for years has been anything that was there before can be replicated in exact what was there. That's our policy. You want to put a window in, you got to put back the exact window that was there. You can't, you know, put a modern one or on top next to one of the old ones.
Yeah.
And that's been the policy here. And the answer when the public get disarrayed about this, you can say, look, they had 1 year ago. The past policy has always been you can replace what was existing in age. And we've always done that, you know. And I say this is a catch-22 because we got stuck in the middle of it, you know. I wasn't on it. I missed it. But I'm just saying that to say that they got to take it down or take them to court, it's going to be just a waste of time and money. They have a legal permit for it.
Yeah, I don't think anybody's going to take it.
Well, I have a question. I mean,
yeah.
I know we're looking at one particular application. There may have been other ones that were successive after this, but they don't have chimneys.
And
they didn't apply to...
What?
Well, you just pointed it out. And
it's not a complete... The construction's not complete. They haven't done the chimneys. And it will make a presentation... The perception of that sign will be different
you
with
mean
the chimneys.
Right.
Got it.
sorry.
And they don't, they don't have shutters. You know, so in other words, you're not really restoring it back to exactly how it was as a store. So technically,
they didn't put this sign back.
The sign appropriate.
John, what do you have to say?
I was just gonna, they haven't finished construction.
Okay.
Right.
Okay, so the chimneys are going to get built.
I'm not sure what the, if it's.
Well, if they were approved, I mean.
But there's no hole in the roof and it looks done.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, see, that's weird. But there's supposed to be chimneys on it.
Yeah.
Yeah, the point I was trying to make is that the sign, I understand John's point, and we know that with the sign book, we just made changes to the language to address and try and prevent this in the future. But the presentation of this sign on the top of the structure, regardless of the fact that it was there before or not, well, actually, in keeping with the fact that it was there before, it also had a chimney in close proximity, which it doesn't change the sign, but it does change the perception. And as Val pointed out, so do the shutters.
Mm-hmm.
But they're not on that. They're not on the structure. I don't know where the structure is in terms of its level of completion, but certainly when they come in for a final, those should be part of.
You want to know why?
Right?
I think I know why they're not there. Because they had to button this place up. He got the exterior of this building finished so that he could basically stop work through
right.
the summer, because working on Broadway in the summer would be a nightmare.
Yeah.
So I think that he just got the whole thing weather tight, and he's going to break through. None of the inside of this building is done. I mean, I don't think they've started. And so I think in the fall, what they're going to do is they're going to resume work, and the chimneys are going to pop out. So this is
right.
not about a sign-off, right? Like, he didn't come to you. This is just about that people have raised it as an issue.
Correct. Okay.
Okay.
Thank you for clarifying that.
All right. So, yes, John.
Yeah, basically, they don't have a permit to demolish the chimney to begin with. So that's one thing, you know, of food for thought.
Yeah.
Know?
I'd have to check.
Yeah. Although he might be going to put it back. That's fine.
He's...
You know?
Well, if he doesn't,
it would take
the
AI.
The sign,
well, but I think the point that's being
yes,
made,
I understand
Abby,
that,
is that
they haven't
that,
done it themselves. So.
Well,
no, it's that they're
that there's other
to
stuff.
Yeah.
Like somebody mentioned to me, and it was no one on the board. Somebody said, "Well, but what you're not seeing is the chimney that's going to anchor the sign." You know, so that's part of it.
That's what we just said.
Oh well, somebody else told me that like a week ago.
I can't make out the last two signatures. Do you know who they are?
Yeah, you're the
I think one.
I wasn't on it.
I think
this was in 15.
I wasn't even born yet.
I think that's you and Linda.
That's Kat.
Christine. I'm second from the bottom.
Yeah, one would be Christine.
Christine Blazer.
Yeah, Christine's the bottom one.
Okay.
And then me.
And you, Ray, and me, and Linda.
Yeah.
Linda did the writing down here.
Yeah.
I did not do that.
Okay.
That's her.
Gabby, writing the other one.
No, I'm not on that. No, my mountains are not there.
Okay, now here's one other small thing that I want to mention about this, because I have given this a tremendous amount of thought. I read the new sign guidelines, okay, because I was like, okay, what's a sign? Because I wasn't really, I mean, look,
sure,
this is a sign. The current sign guidelines say anything that's advertising a product, giving directions to a place of business, there's certain things, but none of them applied to this sign, because
mm-hmm.
this is not a store.
Yeah.
And so this, to me, is more like a historic marker, okay? So the new guidelines, which have not yet, well, actually, they were just ratified. We just did it last Tuesday. Add language that says anything that will cause attention to itself. Well, now, this sign under the new guidelines certainly does call attention to itself. But under the old guidelines, it's not, you know, advertising a store. It's not showing directions to a store. So...
Does it say anything that might cause attention to it?
That's in the new sign guidelines, the one that we just approved.
It's like having a horse without a saddle.
Exactly.
Well, or
anything.
Or
a bay window is a sign.
Peanut without jelly.
Okay.
Yes.
So, any further discussion on this?
No. Or do you think that it's, I mean, this is just something that was inadvertent and it's an example of what not to do in the future? Or do you think that there's a possibility of reaching out to these people and saying, you know?
These people are fully aware of the controversy. Right.
I do find it odd that you would want people to mistake your house for a store, but, you know, that's just me.
My guess is that they're going to have people banging on their door all summer long, the windows, everything, because they're thirsty for a drink, and the sign will come down of its own accord.
Yeah.
That's what I believe. But I don't think that it's, right now, it's not in our place, because, look, they have legitimate approval. That's one thing.
Do we have the
second thing is, they haven't even requested a sign-off yet, so this whole discussion is really kind of premature because John hasn't done the walkthrough for the final, and I don't expect him to be doing that until next spring,
mm-hmm.
honestly. So,
so we're not taking an up or down vote right now?
Well, there's nothing to vote on,
right.
You know, because there's at the moment there's no application. You know, this is not an application. This is, we're just reviewing this.
Mm-hmm.
So
it brings up an interesting point. It
brings up many interesting
points. One of which is there is an historical precedent for this specific site on this specific structure, but now it doesn't look appropriate anymore. I'm just mentioning that. It's
right.
One of the most obvious things. I'm the master of the obvious.
But that's
regard.
Why I think when we say things like that are in the book or we're making see other books, that each application has to be taken on its own merit because clearly it was the Sconset store.
And that type
but
of sign.
But right now it's inappropriate.
Right.
So I think it just, we
right.
can make as many rules as we want, but each application has to be taken.
Well, and I think the significance of the rules and the regulations is the rules and regulations may pertain to things that are solid and fixed. For instance, who applies for what, when, and how, but then the rules and the regulations refer to the guidelines that can be changed by the HTC from time to time, so that you have that flexibility in applicants, but then you have the counterpart, which are the guidelines, so that, like the guidebook, so that the applicants have goalposts. They know where the sidelines are, they know when the whistle's going to blow, but it's not hard and fixed. To your point, Abby, is that there's some flexibility, because we got to be able to do this on a case-by-case basis.
We definitely.
So I think that's just a really interesting discussion to have when
we have to be able to not approve something because the house next door was approved with it. I mean,
well, there's no other signs on Nantucket sitting on top of a roof ridge like that.
Well, there was. That was
the
old Nantucket hotel.
I think some of the hotels.
The Nantucket hotel said Nantucket across the top.
Like Hollywood?
Kind of like Hollywood. But the other thing, if you recall, when we had the discussion about the sign guidelines Tuesday night, Stephen added language that said more or less that...
Diane did.
That it would be a requirement for any sign to go before the sign committee before it came to us. Not sort of sometimes, whenever, that it always would be. So then this right now, we wouldn't find ourselves in
I don't think our sign committee was quite so active when this happened.
Well, they have very
this.
Strong opinions
yeah.
about it. That
well,
are,
when was
they were
bypassed, this?
And they're feeling
2 years ago?
I mean, I think they've consolidated
themselves. Is it possible to find the minutes covering this meeting back in...
Minutes are important.
Okay, folks, listen up. John is going to give us a history lesson.
I don't think anybody here can remember about me, but anyway, Millie's Ice Cream Parlor out in Madigan. Now there's a sign, and it says Millie's. It's all it says is Millie's.
Mm-hmm.
About 4.5 feet long, foot high. The building is here. It's just above the door.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's just above the door. She had ice cream every Saturday and Sunday.
At her place?
Yeah.
Millie's. Millie Jewett.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You're saying they had this big sign out there too, you know?
Yeah.
And across the street, the guy had a gas station. You know?
Yeah, but you know what's incongruous about this is now we have a
the renovation is exquisite. If you go, if you drive by, it's just amazing the detail they put into the this house with the, it's got the, but it's just, you know, that sign, Millie's, was, you know, it was a rundown building. It was Mildred Jewett. She had Jewett. She had this, the whole character. This is incongruous because it's been impeccably renovated, and then the old sign on top, it's almost Disneylandish, rather than
it's very, very there, it's like in your face.
You know, Millie's.
There are many signs around town that were on a building, and over the years, the building was added to and this and that, and the old signs were put back, you know, some of them, you know, for memory's sake, not because of the business you had, you know.
Right.
I wrote down, I done a study, and I wrote down that I could sconce it in town, every single quarter board that I could find on this island. And I published a book on Nantucket, a couple of books. In there was one, there was that, and I published another one that had nicknames.
For people?
I had 102 nicknames that I could think of in a short time, you know.
Yeah.
And I put it in the newspaper. And there we go.
Right.
Well, anyway, I shouldn't have done it in a way, because my wife is home and I'm not all the time, right? Phone me. Hello, yeah, this is Bob Jones. Yeah, you forgot my name. He had to write all that stuff down. So anyway, I wrote a second letter. Maybe 6 months later, another 100. There's 200 nicknames on this island. You know, but it's just... I wrote a book in 1984.
It might be time to republish.
But I wrote one book that is from 16 Nantucket evolution from 1654, I think.
1659.
Are you sure?
Yep, positive.
Yeah. Scholars say you're wrong, but anyway.
When the first settlement?
1659. Whatever, up to 1975. And all the changes in the government and people and what happened and fishing.
Wow.
It's a big thing, you know. I don't think I can find it at home.
Huh.
Mm. And, you know, that was my hobby. Valerie, one question. One question.
What?
When people come up to you today or tomorrow and say, what the hell is that big sign doing up on that roof? What are you going to say?
I'm going to say... Oliver likes the sign, it should remain.
But here is,
but it's not in the motion.
You may have
the motion to approve through staff.
That's an hour.
With the east elevation left gable window to remain. North left gable window remains existing centered. And west elevation second floor bay center window to remain as existing.
Those are the minutes from this approval.
This is the motion to approve on December 22nd of 2015.
Okay.
That was the motion. I made that motion.
Okay.
It says nothing about the sign.
Somehow it made it onto that thing. I don't know.
I didn't write that.
I know.
The chairman wrote that.
Yeah.
Do you want me to go back and listen to the audio and see if I missed it?
Listen, as I said before, and John, I know that you want to say something, but let me just say this. This whole discussion is really very premature. Nobody has requested a sign-off yet. So, I mean, kind of, you know, it's like having a porta potty in front of a building.
The building's built?
No, it's like during construction, you're not really supposed to be evaluating the building. Like, oh, you said there was going to be a window there and it's not there. When it comes down to the final, you know, walkthrough, when John goes out for the last time, he verifies that everything is on there. Now, if there's any issue, look, my recollection, I sat on that, is that we were very sort of loved everything about bringing the old building back to what it was. So, Terry, thank you. I don't think you necessarily need to listen to the tapes now.
Let's wait and see.
We'll see what happens.
Yeah, let's
let's see if somebody brings it up.
If the minutes are wrong, he can correct them.
Okay, yeah. Yes, John.
Mr. Chairman, I was going to say, I don't know why it's written on the COA. However, it doesn't need to be included in the minutes since it was shown right on the slant.
Correct.
I mean, the motion didn't need to include a brief
that is window. Correct.
You know, so it's all.
Can I just ask, what precipitated this discussion?
There was a lot of neighborhood, you know, well.
Tell me the plans.
There was neighborhood stuff, and then it also came to me via sign committee. Kevin Kuster said, you know, look, A, we've been getting a lot of complaints, and B, we kind of don't understand why that didn't come before our board, because it's a sign, and I didn't really have an answer for that.
Okay,
so
I just wanted to make sure I understand.
Yeah, I'm not sure.
Thank you.
In 15, every sign that came up went in front of the sign.
Yeah, maybe not.
Well, it's
done
now.
It will now.
Yeah, it's very serious
now. Well, corner boards don't have to.
They don't.
No, that's a specific exception.
We weren't as precise then as we are being now.
Absolutely.
We keep getting sharper and sharper.
Lemonade.
Yeah. Oh, man.
Okay, so can I have a motion?
Motion to...
Ray?
Yes, sir.
Get this week's inky that has the places for rent.
Yeah.
Now, I'm for sale?
Yeah.
That's in there. The house. With the store.
Okay.
No, you're kidding me.
They were so disrupted by the whole controversy, they're selling the house.
It's not finished.
Motion to adjourn.
Are you joking?
I can't. Oh, God.